Okay. Welcome everybody to our webinar today. My name is John Gilbert and I lead the tech support team here in the US for phase one. In addition to that, I basically run the phase one certified professional program. We've been doing that for a number of years. So if there's anybody out there sort of wondering about it, wondering if we're gonna start doing events again, we absolutely are, but not until it is safe to do so. So stay tuned on all of those fronts. Like you guys most likely are, we're all working from home here at Phase One. So welcome to the new US Phase One support headquarters. If you see a furry friend, small child wander in, don't be alarmed. Apparently this is my dining room. So everything is a little bit different these days, but we're making the best that we can. And we're out here trying to help you guys out, serve all our customers. And hopefully keep people educated and hopefully entertained. So all that said, it is absolutely my pleasure to introduce you to Andrei Duman. Now, Andrei, as a photographer, I've gotten to know over the last couple of years. And I think he's one of the most unique photographers that we work with. Kind of a little bit about how I got involved with him is he's always got a special project going on. And when Andrei does a special project, it's usually pushing the limits in one way or another. And so when that happens, it usually requires some sort of custom tech support. And that's what we try to be all about here at Phase One. So one of the things that is really amazing about Andrei is that if we look at a lot of photographers, and I think we all have a tendency to do this in our own photography, is we find something we're good at, we concentrate on that, maybe we sort of master that one area, we develop a style, but a lot of photographers get really pigeonholed into one area. And that's great for marketing, it's great for how people think about it. But Andrei is a guy who doesn't get pigeonholed anywhere. His work spans variety, spans style, and he's always sort of pushing the limits. And it's really refreshing, I think, to see somebody who can be shooting aerials one week, still life the next, and always doing something just really, really interesting. And I think you're gonna see that today as we look through a couple of different projects that he's had over the years. So let me bring him in here and I'll turn it over to him to introduce himself and tell you a little bit about him.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. I appreciate that intro and thank you for phase one. Welcome everyone. I hope you're all safe and well in this most interesting and difficult of times. Please stay safe, stay healthy. Please follow the government guidelines until we can hopefully all go back and be a little bit more creative and be able to travel. So thank you again for the intro. I think I've been trying to think of how I wanted to really start talking about who I am, what I do. And I think it, just to give you a little bit of a background, let me tell you a little bit my life story very, very quickly. So I was born in Romania, a place that very few people probably know or get an idea of where it is and what it's all about, right? Dracula and Nadia Comăneci and all that fun stuff. But it was during communist times and it was really, the environment was very much suppressed, right? So I remember even just the buildings were very monotone in color. Maybe it had two shades of gray, or that's about as extreme as it really got. And you really felt that. I didn't feel that when I was a kid, but looking back on it now, it really sort of shaped the way that you see the world around you. It wasn't a great deal of color. It wasn't a great deal of ability to express yourself. And, I started playing tennis from a very young age in Romania just to try and express myself. And we moved to the UK, continued with my tennis career. But one thing that really stuck with me was when we first moved to the UK, I was driving in a taxi, and we stopped at a traffic light. And on the left-hand side, literally it was close to the airport, on the left-hand side was a sweet shop. It was, and this was just unreal because we just didn't have any of that. We'd barely, queue for hours just to get bread or go to a store where didn't have anything really on the shelves. So it was a store that was full of sweets and it had those massive, those huge tubes that have different colors and everything was just super happy and bright. And it had the most profound effect on me. It was just a different world. And sort of that developed, the more I spent time in the UK, the thinking is different. So it really kind of started to sort of shape what I was doing. Also continuing with my tennis career, I really I was lucky. I was good. I was athletic, and I got pretty decent at what I was doing. I started traveling the world internationally, playing tournaments, representing the UK in a few of those. And what was interesting about that, and this is where my love for travel really started, was for you to get those international points, you have to go to really far off places. You don't go to where the strong tournaments are, like Italy or Germany or France or whatever. You have to go, you know, Brunei and Syria and Tunisia, just to hope that the competition isn't as strong, and then you pick up points and you keep moving on. So at a very young age, I was exposed to this culture that, again, was just so varied and different. One week was you know, I was in Asia, another week I was in on the African continent, and everything was, and I was traveling on my own. So trying to sort of navigate that almost sort of woke me up and sort of made me maybe grow up a lot more and exposed me to so many different things. And I always had a camera with me. You know, it was a tiny little pathetic 2.8 megapixel, I think it was a Sony CyberShot. So, but everywhere I was going, I wanted to document it. So I wanted to be able to look back and remember some of these places. And sort of as technology developed and I got more and more into it, you progress. You keep buying new cameras and you upgrade. And my first SLR was a Canon 80D, if I'm not mistaken. It was an 8.2 megapixel. And at the time that was, you know, the largest one, I think, was like 15. It was a Mark One. So, you know, you kept sort of moving with the times, and I kept shooting as much as I could. Tennis ended, unfortunately, and I got into finance. So I started doing investment banking, started in London, and moved to New York in 2005. And again, complete different world. Very much suppressed in many ways that people don't quite realize. You think it's this glamorous thing, and it really isn't. The last job I had was at UBS. I was a sales trader on the equity complex and hybrid equity derivative desk. You know, the products that brought down the market in 2008. You can thank me for that. And again, six screens, working insane hours, incredibly stressful. There was just no opportunity for me to, A, continue with my photography or do anything to sort of, I just had no time. I remember coming in around 6:30 in the morning, and I'd leave at around 1:30. In the morning every single day, and sometimes coming in on weekends. So again, it was just that I just felt this suppression on me that I couldn't really do what I wanted. I just had no time, I had no opportunity. Even if I did, I was too tired. The beauty with that was they would force you to take 2 weeks out at a time, just in case you were, because I was on a trading desk, just in case you were hiding a trade. The idea is there would, you know, within a 2 week period, some system would alert that you've done something wrong. And you can't touch your emails, you can't touch your phone. And again, 2 week gap, I'm not going to just go to Mexico or Canada. I'm going to go really far because I have that time. So we went to Vanuatu, we went to Palau, we went to all these places in Asia and Africa that wouldn't have allowed me if I just had a week, just because of the time difference and how long it takes and everything. So it was really continuing my tennis experience and wanting to explore the world and go to these different places and kind of carry that on. And as I sort of added a location that I wanted to see, such as, you know, the Jellyfish Lake in Palau was high on my list. I would always, once I checked that off, I always had three more that I was adding. So my list was always, even though I was knocking them off, it was always growing. So I guess that was a good thing about banking. But 12 years of doing that, had enough. My wife and I said, you know what, let's move to LA. She's originally from LA. And it was just, again, a complete different laid back sort of environment. And it was really the travel work. So if I can show some of, I'll share my screen. I'm not going to go through all of them just because we can go back to that a little bit later. But in terms of the travel work that I was doing, it was just trying to be as expressive as I could. With the locations, with the sort of what I was really trying to do. So for example, this one was in Munich, in the subway systems, where I'd had to go at 3 or 4 in the morning. So I made sure there was no one around. So I had the whole system to myself, traveling to Switzerland. This one's in, we had the opportunity to go to the boxes in Havana, in Cuba. I'm sure this has been shot a million billion times. This was my take on it, actually done with frame averaging, which was incredible to see the detail in Zion. Amazing. Again, so for me, it was really just the variety of the locations and also the colors. For me, colors are crucial. It's just happy. It's exciting. It's you know, it's vibrant. It's sort of something that I really seek in the work that I do. So travel was a hugely important part of what I was really wanting to necessarily achieve. And I wanted to continue with that. So it wasn't necessarily just going to these amazing locations. It was also my love of taking that from the ground, but also being up in the air. And I adore shooting aerials. To me, it's an incredibly different experience. You really have to understand your camera and your settings, because with landscape, it's very static, right? There's only so much you can use. You stop, you take your time, you do your composition. You have the time, you have a little bit of freedom. Whereas when it comes to aerial work, everything changes. The environment is constantly moving. You really have to understand, there we go. From in terms of the settings, your composition is just always on the move. Mm-hmm. I prefer helicopters and planes. I like to actually shoot with the doors off, so I never go unless it's with the door off. This was an interesting one. This was over LAX. It was allowing us to shoot under the airport as planes were sort of landing underneath us. But again, I look for patterns and I look for color. Really, that's kind of one of the things that drives me. And the research that you do is staggering as well on my end. I spend months trying to find a location. This perfect example, just outside of Barcelona, a 3-hour drive from Barcelona, the most incredible formations that unfortunately didn't land there, but I think it's used for farming purposes. But it's the color and the shapes and really the composition that sort of drives a lot of what I'm doing. So in a nutshell, that was my sort of travel and aerial section of things. And continuing with the phase one, just giving you that extra flexibility in terms of what I was really trying to shoot in the highest possible quality. One of the things that you mentioned as well, which I'd like to sort of go back to, which is, I don't like to be pigeonholed. I mean, a lot of people saw me as just a travel and an aerial photographer. But to me, that just, how much I love it and I'm always going to be doing it, I always felt like I needed something a little bit more, something else I can experiment in the time that I wasn't traveling or doing an aerial shoot. So I really got into sort of the studio aspect of things, really wanting to push that, again, playing with colors and playing with compositions to express something in a different way. And it gave me a sort of a different sort of freedom that I can play with what I was, again, with the colors and really the concept. So dropping paint in water and trying to sort of see how that shape happens and what goes with it, or dipping vegetables in paint as sort of like a unique concept for some restaurants from a fine art perspective. And even when I'm introducing the human aspect, I still want to keep that sort of unique look of the colors that really sort of make it pop. I wanted to mention, sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, you know, looking at those, there's, even though they're these very different subjects, there's this theme that, you know, when I look at the colorful powder in these shots, it reminds me of your aerial work. You know,
you have
the pattern, you have the color, you have the composition. It's a completely different environment, but when you understand what the camera's doing and when you understand sort of photography on a deep level, you adapt to those situations.
Yeah, and my work isn't always about color. If, for example, I had the opportunity to work with Tony Hawk, where I presented to him this really kind of unique idea that he said, he actually mentioned himself, that he's never done before, whereby we went to his half pipe at San Diego, where we built these gigantic platforms literally on the floor of the half pipe. And you can see all the lighting setup that we did. We painted it the day before. And I was basically up in this cherry picker, where we had four lights from underneath that were in flash sync, obviously with the camera. And we got him to spray paint as he's skating. And he created this sort of almost Jackson Pollock sort of style look. Mm-hmm. So even though I'm not using paint on him, I'm still trying to incorporate the composition and sort of the colors to make something that's a little bit different and unique. Let's think outside the box. How can we do it? And this is one of the final, you know, one of the final images that were used. And he's using it for his foundation. And in fact, they actually ended up chopping this in boards and selling it to raise money for the foundation, which is really great.
Yeah, still go ahead and
do that. yeah, it was great. At the same time, just shooting, quote unquote, what I call regular product photography is just, again, using your skill set that you've utilized and learned through time, through mistakes, through all these things that you didn't think that a project that you're doing, you that absolutely failed and you'd never use again, you actually end up learning something that you then apply to something else. So for me, this was a great example of focus stacking. So utilizing, Richard Mille reached out to me and said, Andre, we're launching this new product. This was actually the Sylvester Stallone watch, which was $1.1 million, I think it was. And they came down to the studio with literally a guy in handcuffed to a briefcase. And we really had to light this in a very unique way, because there's just so much going on here. There's so many different facets and details, especially for them that have open-faced watches. So focus stacking is all the way through actually to the end of where the mirror is at the top. So, and the lighting too, actually, we did a cross-sectional lighting. So we lit separate sections of it, then lit a complete different section, and we combined all those images together after they've been focus stacked. So a few examples of some of the watches that we did for them. This was a one of five, I think it was. It was a $1.6 million watch. It was a green sapphire.
Well, that's green sapphire. I thought that was plastic.
That's incredible. For 1.6, I hope it's green sapphire. it's utilizing some of the skill sets that you're learning to then apply to something completely different. And that really fascinates me, because it's completely different than, you know, going on any sort of shoots, or whether it's aerial, landscape, mm-hmm. you're just utilizing something for the next shoot.
Yeah, well, and I think as you sort of go into some of these things, I mean, it's easy to look at a lot of what you think of it as compositionally very simple images. It's an object on black sort of fading into the back. And we often forget the technical level that goes into producing an image like this. And it's, if you can master this, you know, think about how does that affect then, you know, what you're doing in landscape, what you're doing in travel, what you're doing in aerial.
Yeah, and you're absolutely right. In fact, we spent, for this particular watch, we ended up only doing two shots, and it took us a day and a half, pretty much half a day, just to get the lighting correct, mm-hmm. In terms of the way that we wanted to put all the lighting situations together, and then just shooting it for the other few days and trying to focus stack them. And then obviously the post that's associated with this is quite strenuous and takes a lot of time, because of the detail that you're able to get with the phase. It's not like a, you know, like a regular 35 mil, you can see so much more of the imperfections. In fact, even Richard Mille themselves, we pointed out to them that, hey, inside the watch, there are actually some scratches that they didn't, obviously you can't see with a naked eye. So they found that quite interesting that we can actually get that amount of detail. This one was shot on the IQ4. So again, these are some of the projects that I'm doing. I'm always sort of, I have another 10 going at the same time. And as an example of that, one of them was, I wanted to X-ray you sort of certain everyday projects. I wanted to see what the inside looks like. So this is actually an Apple MacBook Pro. And it's really interesting, again, to see sort of the intricacies of the everyday product that we kind of take for granted and not realize what's fully underneath it. A PlayStation 4 controller, for example, where you can see the accelerometers in the handles. But one of the main reasons why I wanted to do it, I wanted to see what the phase, some of the phase lenses and actually the phase one mm-hmm. itself would look like in an X-ray. So this is the 40, the 80 mil lens. And this is what your IQ, the whole setup is.
Optical designers and engineers, take note. Want to copy our products, this is the time to do it.
Absolutely. But so I wanted to just give you a really brief overview on again, some of the things that I've done. But I wanted to use this time to really focus on mm-hmm. three projects that kind of highlight the variety of stuff of subjects that I like to shoot and how I kind of went about doing it, because they're very different in composition, very different in sort of the color tones that we use, but also the planning of it. And the first one that I want to talk about is CERN. If people are not familiar with CERN, would highly advise me to do a little bit of research. But if it took me close to a year of constantly trying to find the right contact. And it wasn't that they were ignoring me and they were just incredibly busy doing what they were doing. I kept getting bounced around. I can't find someone. And I really said to them, look, I, I want to shoot this with the highest quality possible camera that you can get. You can use the images for your own promotional material. I just think that I can capture something that's never been done before, because they told me it's never been shot on a phase one. So for those that don't know, CERN is the largest machine that has ever been built by man. And that in itself is just kind of insanely scary just to really sort of think about it. And it's basically a gigantic particle collider that is 100 meters underground, so around 300 and something feet underneath Switzerland and parts of France. And it is a gigantic tube that's almost cylindrical. It's 17 miles long, so the circumference, the whole tube itself is 17 miles long. And there are four sections where when they turn it on, they fire particles towards each other. And the idea is when they smash, you then see what the fall off of that particle looks like. And the idea is to get a sense of what it looked like right after the Big Bang. That's really the ultimate, if I can say it in a non, I'm not a physicist or a scientist, but that's the way it is. And some of the stats before I show the images are just mind boggling, because it's important to sort of lay what I was about to sort of delve into. So when they turn on the machine, they run it continuously for 10 hours. Every single second, there are a billion collisions of these particles, these proton to proton collisions. There's a billion of these collisions every single second. And that particle travels around the entire circumference of it 11,000 times per second. So it's going at 99.9% speed of light. So just that in itself is just insane to really sort of grapple your head with. So if I can show you the first image that I really think highlights this. Oops. This is one of the experiments. This is the largest one that they have. This is called CMS. And usually when it's turned on, everything is put together and it's moved into the slot. So right now it's fully open because they're doing some construction on it. For this project, we ended up using a technical camera. It was a Cambo that we did with the 23 millimeter lens and the IQ4. And the reason for that was, and you can't see this in this image, but these were not built to be photographed. These are actual scientific experiments. So everything is super tight. You're super close to these things. So I needed to be able to stitch. And that's with the Cambo. And the same as the XT that you have behind you, it gives you that flexibility to be able to adjust your focus. So this particular image is 76 individual stitched images of an IQ4. And my researcher wasn't not happy about this, because the final file size of this was 46 gigabytes. So this is a JPEG, obviously, because we'd be here forever trying to load it up, but it's 46 gigabytes, this one final image.
I've worked on professional photo shoots that produce less data than that.
this is the world we live in. And in fact, again, continuing with some of these insane stats, this section here that you see, this is where the magnet is. And this is the largest superconducting magnet in the world. In fact, when it's turned on, it can produce more than 100,000 times the magnetic pole of the Earth. So these are just insane numbers. It can melt, I think, 18 tons of gold. It just has that much capacity. So capturing this in detail, this is actually a TIFF file that I have here. And the reason why it's a TIFF is I wanted to give you the option to sort of zoom in and really see what it's like at 100%. So just right here is 100% in terms of the detail. And we can easily push this to 300-400 and you still be able to read certain words and letters on here. I mean, this is one of the reasons why I wanted to capture this in this kind of detail. It's incredibly rare to get to this place. Obviously, I was given unprecedented access by the scientists. You're not going to come here very often. You want to be able to make sure that you collect the best quality file that you can possibly get.
Well, I think this image in particular, when you look at all the stuff that's in there, all the different colors, all the different wires, it really, the thing that makes this image is the detail. And you see it when it's small, you see it when it's big. Because I think one of the, misconceptions, I think, is that in a lot of areas, people sort of look at, some of the things like the IQ4 150 at 150 megapixels and say, well, you know, do I need that? Do I benefit from that? This is an image that that camera is just built for. And it's, you know, I feel like I spend most of my time telling people about how, well, yeah, you have all the resolution, but what you really want the camera for is the color, the sensitivity, or the speed of shooting, or the way it adapts to different workflows. I mean, I shoot my Christmas card with an IQ4 150 and it gets printed, you know, this big.
Right.
But then you throw it into this situation and we have all the wires, all the detail, all the nuts and bolts, all the lettering, and you can see into all those little parts. You know, the dynamic range is giving you information in the shadows.
Yeah, and that was absolutely huge, because again, this was not meant to be, it's not built to be photographed. This is built to be a fully working experiment. So the lighting isn't perfect here. I can't bring external lights. I have to work with what I have. And even just getting inside of it, there's only so much gear you can bring. There were multiple checkpoints. We had a Geiger meter the whole time to make sure that radiation wasn't where we were going, had enough radiation that you don't have that sort of studio ability to just, okay, I'm going to light it this way now, and then I'm going to move it over here. So you really sort of have a short amount of time to be able to get that one shot. And this, you know, having that availability in terms of the resolution just makes, it really just made the whole experience that much better.
One thing that I just want to add sort of outside of this, we are going to take a couple questions at the end of each little section here when we talk about CERN and some of the other projects. We're going to take more questions at the end. So there are a couple questions waiting, and don't worry, we'll pick you guys up in a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely. So let me just switch back to, so this is actually another one of the experiments. This was Atlas. This is the largest wheel that they have, and it's around 25 meters, which is gigantic. So it's hard to sort of even with the lenses that I had, which was a 23, it was really hard to quantify just the full size of it. Funnily enough, if anyone is a big heavy metal fan, this was Kerry King out of Slayer. While we were there, he was doing a private, because they were playing in Geneva, and he was there to do a private tour of the facility, and I managed to snap a quick photo of him. Again, going into the detail, and this is a better example to sort of show the size of it. You have a gentleman here in the lower right hand corner to give it perspective, but it's just incredible the level that you're able to capture, and not only what you're able to capture, but what you can play with in post. Yes, some sections are dark, but I can easily push that up without destroying the file. That's completely changes the whole game. So it's just that flexibility in terms of the dynamic range of what you can do to push certain sections of the file without really destroying it. This one, so this experiment is actually Alice. It's one of the hardest ones to really get into. And we were given pretty insane access. This is actually underneath what you're looking over here. This is the underneath section of it, which continues with all these just insane wires that are just flying everywhere. So there you go. Hopefully the detail is coming through properly on everyone's screens as I'm sort of moving across to really be able to see it. We're at 100% here, so I can only imagine this printed, you're going to have incredible detail all the way through. And one of the rarest things was we were actually allowed, and you literally had to crawl through a tiny little space to go inside the experiment itself. So this is where all the particles are moving at 99% speed of light and colliding. So that section is inside of here. Only a few scientists apparently were even allowed to be in there, but we somehow managed to sneak in and do that. And this is a stitched image too. This was a 5 or 6 image panel. Lastly, from this particular shoot, this is a decommissioned piece of kit. And what's really incredible about this, and I think this is probably the craziest stat from that entire shoot, is that inside this decommissioned piece of equipment was the highest temperature ever recorded in the universe. So for a split second, they managed to get 9.9 trillion degrees Fahrenheit inside that. It is over 300,000 times hotter than the center of the sun. So they're just incredible pieces of technology that are really being worked on here. Mm-hmm. And it was just incredible to be able to shoot it. It's one of those one of those rare, one of a kind experiences, really. So from that, let's go on to the second one, which I wanted to share with you. So going from doing sort of architectural where you were really restricted in terms of the location and how tight you can be, it's kind of refreshing to then jump into something completely different, which was doing a shoot that I did recently for McLaren Automotive. Now, for those that don't know me, I'm a huge car nut, and I love again, technology and how things move, and just obsessed with cars. And I've been a huge fan of McLaren since the early F1 days, ever since they came out with, even with the F1 car. It's just been something that is, I just like the way they do things. They just do things differently, and they don't really follow the norm, which I genuinely appreciate. And they allowed me the opportunity to shoot something that was quite rare. For those that don't know, their regular cars are already pretty extreme, but they've also do these really hardcore versions, and that's the GTR program. And it's done by their sort of Skunk Works MSO section in the UK. And they have two of them that are incredibly rare that I had a chance to shoot, which was the P1 GTR and the Senna GTR. And I believe the McLaren gentleman from North America might be on, and he confirmed that it's the first time, I think, that they've ever had those two cars in the same studio, sitting on the same slot. So going through the images and how we were approaching this shoot was again very a complete different mindset, because you've got that much more space. You have that much more flexibility with the lighting. You can really take your time and focus on different sections rather than sort of like a gung-ho, not necessarily gung-ho like we did at CERN, but we were sort of restricted on time and the accessibility that we can get into. So the background we sort of struggled with, in a sense of how we wanted to show the background. Do we want to keep it white? Do we want to put it CG into as if it's on a racetrack or something along those lines? And we ultimately decided to really play off the colors of the car itself and sort of make it into a vintage, almost like a vintage montage, really, for these incredibly rare cars. But the setup was really the most challenging. The lighting of the cars was the most challenging. There's so much going on with these cars. So many nooks and crannies. The wing is absolutely insane and massive, and all these things coming off it that you have to really pay attention to and light individually. So it took us around a day to get about two shots, because we spent the entire time finding the right angle, finding the right height, finding the right lens that we were going to be using. Mm-hmm. For this one, I think we're mostly on either the 120 or the 150. And then lighting the different sections individually, and then focus stacking those sections. So if you can imagine the number of files that we were really, really playing with on this, was quite insane. As you can see, I mean, look at the back on that thing. It's absolutely crazy. And again, even some of the stats on this are pretty insane. There are only 75 of these that were ever made, 841 horsepower, and it can, at full downforce, the downforce it can create is 2,200 pounds, which is almost as heavy as the car itself, which is just, again, crazy, insane numbers. And it costs around $2 million. So, you know, these are not cheap machines. And you want to treat them with care, and I wanted to do them justice and really take our time with the way we lit it. The second one that we did, which was, so that one was, this is the Senna GTR. And then this other one was the P1 GTR. What's really special about this car is that, again, they only had about 58 ever made, but the gentleman that owns this car sent it back to McLaren to make it street legal. So this is one of the only cars in the world that can actually drive on a regular road, as opposed to all the other GTRs that are only for racing. And in addition to that, it's hard to see in this particular image, but he asked them to do two tones of orange, which is, one of them is the McLaren orange that then fades into the other color itself. So this car costs around $6.5 million, which is pretty incredible. But again, trying to find the right lighting conditions and being able to get the right composition is really what took a long time for us to really
Well, and I think really, I mean, if you look at this image, it's the subtleties that make it work. It's the light catching the rear fenders. It's all of those little panels being ever so slightly illuminated that you really get a feeling for what's there and the curves and everything else. And I can just and this imagine one's the actually, time that goes into making that all.
And this one, I downloaded this as a TIFF, and I wanted to show you again at 100% the fact that you can read the tiny numbers and letters that are on the side of the tire from here going to 100%, and getting that kind of, again, that kind of resolution is really why McLaren wanted us to use, they were actually asking for us to use the phase one camera, because they needed that sort of resolution. It really fit their brand to be able to have this photographed in this particular way.
And even there, it's not even about just the overall size of the image. You have to be able to resolve the detail in the first place. And that's,
absolutely.
That's the thing that, you know, I've always found over, 15 years of working with phase one digital backs and medium format was, it was not always the fact that the images were larger. It was even when the images were the same size, that the details, the fine bits of sharpness that you're resolving were always just so much more in medium format.
Yeah, and it's just cleaner edges. Your noise levels are that much lower. So it just, again, you can just push these files to a level that you simply can't do with many other systems. It's just, it really comes down to that. And when you see the final product and you print it in a huge, in a large format like McLaren sometimes does, that is so incredibly evident when it gets to that stage. As a final shot for this particular project, I really wanted, this was a shot that I definitely wanted to get, which was the overhead. And we spent an entire day just getting this shot. It was incredibly difficult. The studio itself actually had a little doghouse at the top that you had to climb through the side of the building, hike up all your gear, bring your laptop, bring your tripod, bring your everything along with it, and sort of point it down in this tiny little manhole, I guess, coordinating with the driver to be able to get millimeters to the left, a little bit to the right. It's not straight, it's not moved, on walkie-talkies the whole time. So just getting it in the right position took quite a few hours, and then we started doing the whole lighting process to it. So, but I think it was, I'm really glad that I persevered on this one, because it's a very unique angle that again, not many people have being able to get on a car that's as rare as this. So that
now,
was that
now
one
when you were on. When you were setting up the camera for this, how were you sort of, because I obviously the car needs to be sort of micro positioned in the right spot to have everything line up the way it does, but on the camera side, I mean, any little deviation in camera angle is going to have a huge effect on the composition. Were you doing anything sort of special up in the
Funnily enough, when we first started shooting, thinking that we have the right lighting set up for the first shot, we were noticing that it was ever so slightly showing some vibrations. And what we found out was it was creating vibrations from us just being inside this doghouse. So what we ended up doing is, after we secured the camera down, we literally stepped outside of the doghouse and got a longer extension to be able to fire it without even touching the wood panel that was around us or even moving. So yes, that was a challenge to be able to get, because again, every detail of this is just can be seen with pinpoint sharpness. So you really have to make sure that everything is dead still.
Yeah. If the tech support guy, if the tech support guy in me can point out one thing here, this is one area where the IQ4 now having Ethernet capabilities can be phenomenal, because you can run 100 meters of Ethernet cable, control it from the ground if you needed to, and sort of be nowhere near the camera. But that's just a technical sidebar.
I think, if I remember correctly, I think we fired that one even remotely. So it's we had to find a solution to a problem that we were having, and it took a little bit longer, but it's worth putting in that time and effort to be able to get the kind of shots that a client like McLaren is expecting to receive as a result of this. So. But again, it was a complete different mindset. It's a complete different setup. You really have to utilize different techniques and different, especially from a lighting environment perspective, to adapt to what the product is and what the client is really the look that they're looking for. So it's just interesting coming from CERN to this. It's a whole different setup. And so we're in the studio for 3 days total. There are more images that I put on the website, but I just wanted to highlight some of these ones in terms of what it took to kind of get these images. And I guess one of the final ones that I wanted to talk to, and I think we'll probably spend a little bit more time on this particular project, is something that this is a personal project that I've been working on for just over a year and a half now. And it's been the most stressful, the most rewarding, the most intricate. It's taught me more about photography than I think anything that I've ever done before. And the reason for that it's just not your everyday type of shoot. So let me jump right into it. And by the way, before I even do that, I wanted to say that this is the first time, and I'm actually, in a sense, I'm quite worried about it, because this is the first time that I'm showing anyone outside of maybe yourself or my researcher has done. No one's really seen these images before, so I'm hoping that people like them and understands when we talk a little bit more what really took to make them. So again, since I was a young kid, I've had this fascination with insects, and I've always wanted to, actually, you know what, let me discuss it first before I really jump into it, but I've always wanted to capture these tiny insects that just have the most amazing shapes and colors and textures in a way that really hasn't been done before. But unfortunately, I never quite felt technology quite had that capability to be able to get the kind of detail that I was looking for. Until about a year and a half ago, when the IQ3 came out, when I felt 100 megapixels, if you can do this right, you're going to be able to capture something that really few people have done. So using an automated focus rack that I worked with Alpa, which at the time was a prototype, there was only one of three in the world that were in existence, I can focus stack this particular bug in 1 micron increments. Now, to give you an idea of what a micron is, a human hair is 75 microns. So in the span of a human hair, I can take 75 shots. That is it's a bit extreme. That's, you don't necessarily need to go to that level, but that's where the technology is right now, that you can focus stack and take, for example, what we did with the focus stacking with the watches and the McLaren, you can take that to a whole crazy, insane level. So there you go. So it's insane numbers of the ability to really focus stack that. And I started testing it, and I found out everything was really going wrong. There were so many complications with it, because it's just these levels that it's not your everyday regular shoot. You know, when you focus stack, when it's built into the phase, you can do 50, 60, 70 images, no problem. You can handle that. Mm-hmm. What I was doing was 6,000 images for an insect that is a few millimeters, millimeters.
And we normally think about focus stacking, you know, something that's this big and spending 40 shots to get, you know, there's right. big movements. There's room for error. There's room for mistakes. You and I had a number of phone calls, you know, about this project as it was going on. And it was just, it's all the things that you don't, you look at it on the surface and say, wow, we just need to take like 6,000 images. It's no big deal. And it's like, the logistics of that are just mind boggling.
Yeah. And I really wanted to, this is going to sound horrible, but I wanted to see where this technology can go. I wanted to really push it. At which point does that phase break? And let's talk about it. Let's see if we can find a way to really make this thing work. Because again, the numbers are insane. Shooting 6,000 frames continuously every 3 seconds, it fires a shot. It can last 5 or 6 hours of continuous shooting. That's a lot of pressure that's being put on that sensor. I'm sure you guys test it out, and I'm sure it can take it. But when I'm doing 40, 50 insects over a span of a few days or weeks, it's really time consuming and puts that strain on it. And I wanted to see at which point does it really start breaking.
And we love situations like that, because it helps us to see what do we need to improve, where do we need to make little changes in the architecture. You know, we've always known the IQ4 has this
just unbelievable amount of processing power built into the back itself. I mean, it's 10 times as powerful as our previous generation of backs. And when you have processors like that, they generate a lot of heat. So when we run it, you know, I remember early on, you had a lot of heat things. And so that gave us sort of an opportunity to really get a clear view of where, you know, problems like that creep in and how we can fix it. And I think, you know, in your case, we were able to, you know, as firmware progressed, sort of eliminate that heat problem.
Yeah. And that was something that I had to put a hold on the project until that was looked into, because it just, I wasn't able to complete it. So once that was done and that was taken care of, I was ready to go. However, there were still other problems that I was having sort of handle on a constant basis. One of them being, for example, because it was a prototype equipment from Apple that I was using, we found that every few microns it would work fine, but then it would have this big jump. It would have this this skip in between frames, or sometimes it would even drop some frames. It's now been resolved, but it was just those growing pains to really get to what I was trying to do. I wanted so badly, and I couldn't quite make it there because we're being held back. But even going back to, you know, focus stacking on such minute, tiny little increments and the depth of field being as shallow, I mean, so incredibly shallow as it had to be, because I'm so close to the insect itself, you needed a super sturdy tripod and no vibrations whatsoever. So putting it on, for example, I remember when I was in the middle of a 3000 stack, my wife, because I have the home studio at my place, my wife would open the garage door, for example, and just vibrated the whole floor. So because of that, I had to stop the stack. If the AC, we had to turn the AC off, for example, because that would throw the stack. You can't walk anywhere. As soon as you turn it on, you have to slowly walk away, or so many tiny little things were affecting it. So I wanted to show you, because I think it's important to see the actual insects themselves. I'm not sure how this is going to come through. And I do want to give a shout out to San Diego Natural History Museum, as well as the University of California, Riverside, because I worked really closely with their entomology department. And these insects, the specimens that I have three of these boxes in my fridge. It's from their private collection. So I wanted to show you one of the insects that I shot. And it's... I'm gonna have to zoom in a little bit more. This is the insect itself. So in terms of size, just so you can sort of see what you're looking at here with sort of the naked eye. And if I can show you the process of what we ended up doing with stacking it. So again, we shoot for 5 or 6 hours continuously. Then we have to convert the IAQ file to a TIFF. That can take around 5 or 6, maybe even longer, 7 hours. And then you run it through a focus stacking software called, I prefer, Zerene, which can take another 7 or 8 hours. And then you have a flattened image that can only then go to the retoucher. And I want to show you what that flattened image looks like. So right, this is, as it's shot, it's just flat TIFF file. And if you zoom all the way in, this is after I've already prepared it and cleaned it. I use my wife's surgical loops to try and clean it as best as I can. This is already being cleaned as far as my human eye can see. And as you can see, this is the level of dust and debris that is all over this particular insect. So all of these things have to get cleaned up. This is no way to finish the file. And even down here where it was just absolute madness that had to get cleaned. So I want to now show you what the final image looks like, which is this. And if I can let it. There we go. If everyone can see that detail. Yeah. So this one took around 46 hours, I believe, of retouching, which if my retoucher is on this webinar right now, is probably still screaming at me because this is the amount of work that's needed to really clean up every single microscopic dust spot that's on these specimens. But this is the level of detail that you're then getting at the end. This is the quality of the file. This is what 150 megapixel stacked image looks like. I mean, these are microscopic hairs.
This is what ends up being, how many shots go into the final image in this case?
This particular one, I think, was just under 3,000.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is around 3,000 of stacked images, flattened into one file.
And just to kind of roughly address one of the questions, just in terms of if anybody's not familiar with sort of the process of focus stacking, the basic concept of it is when we have really shallow depth of field, we just focus on different areas of the object, sort of in a list. So we'd focus here, then here, then here, then here, then here. And then each of those images gets combined together in software. So we can do it two ways. In the XF behind me, the XF can do a focus stack by changing the focus of the lens, actually rotating the lens in very small increments. So your focus is moving that way. In Andre's case, when we go to that level of macro, the camera keeps a fixed focus and we just move it farther and farther and farther away from the subject, and that changed the plane of focus. So, if we're doing something with an XF, we might be doing stacks of anywhere from 5 images up to say 300 images, depending on how big the object is. But when we get this,
which is
small,
what we did,
your depth of
right,
yeah,
and that's
your so depth of field gets so small that it's yeah.
With the watches, for example, when we focus stack the watch, it could be 20 to 30 images. That you combine together. The car was maybe a little bit, maybe a few more, just because of the length of it. That you're starting all the way, especially the 3-quarter one, right? So you start all the way at the back, and then you end all the way at the front. So it has a few more images, maybe 60, for example. What we're talking about here is so many more because of that shallow depth of field. So getting up to 6,000, I'm shooting at 20 microns right now. I can go to 1 micron, but then I'm going to be 20,000 images, which then you start getting into hard drive problems and probably the IQ4 exploding, most likely. But which we don't.
Probably
don't
necessarily, not.
Yeah, well, actually, yeah, I could probably actually still do it. It would run out of juice and hard drive space. But and that's one of the tricky things with even doing the composition for these insects. And I'll put it back up again. What's really difficult? This one is a little bit easier because it's a top-down shot. There are some that I've done that are sort of at a slight, that are a profile image where the leg sticks out closer to the camera, and then the far leg, the one in the extreme, is going obviously the other way. What's really tricky is getting the right composition because these depths of fields are so, so shallow. I can have the front leg to be in focus, but I can't see anything behind. Mm-hmm. So I don't even know where that final leg sits in terms of how the final image will look. So a lot of
you never
really
know what it looks like.
You don't. And to make things worse, it's not as if you try it and then it's right there. Like I can see what it's like. You have to shoot it for 5 or 6 hours. Then you have to convert the file, which takes another 5 or 6. And then you have to flatten the image, which takes about 7. So for you to be able to see what you've done is quite a lot of time to then realize, oh, there's actually a mistake on this, or a leg is going under a bit too much and I'm not happy with that, or the rail skipped and I have to start all over again. Another thing, the software, for example, if the shutter comes across and it doesn't fully take the image, so it's you get half the shutter is done, software doesn't understand that, and after it processes it, it just throws out the file. It doesn't even recognize it, and you have to start all over again after you remove that damaged file. So there's so many things that you think you're close to finishing, and then actually you end up having to start all over again. To give another example, this was the completed TIFF file. No post work on this whatsoever. So again, these are microscopic individual hairs, but also, and I cleaned this. I really did clean this. Look at all the debris microscopic.
And with those fine hairs, I dabble a little bit in retouching, but I wouldn't even dream of touching this. Folks, this is why we have retouchers. They are invaluable.
My retoucher is one of the main reasons why I am where I am, because he just understands what needs to happen. So again, really wanted to point out that I thought this was a clean file when we first had it. I thought it was a clean specimen. And that's what it looks like. And this is the final product. When it loads, it's a big file. There we go. So all of those individual hairs, literally one by one, had to be masked out, had to be cleaned, it's just a crazy process. And this one took the longest out of, so in the year and a half that I've been doing this, I have 17 images that are completed. Mm-hmm. This one took the longest. This one took 82 hours, if I'm not mistaken. 82 hours of retouching after spending however many, 20 odd hours shooting it, converting it, getting it to a point where I can actually send it out to the retoucher. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, I think as expected, we're getting quite a lot of questions about the focus stacking. And so I think this is probably a good time for us to...
I can show one more. I've got one more bug.
Perfect.
So this is just a completed one. But again, just to show the different texture, the different colors, the different level of being able to really capture what this creature is. It's pretty remarkable to see it. So especially on this back, and these purple spots that are just absolutely fascinating with these tiny little holes that, again, I still need to speak to the entomologist to get a better understanding of what they are and what the purpose of it is. But again, a lot of time, a lot of tears and effort have gone into trying to make these images, and mistakes that no one is ever going to see. You're only going to see the sort of final product. But yeah, we can definitely jump into some of the questions if anyone has. I'm sure there's plenty. That kind of wraps up.
You know, there's a couple I think that sort of connect. So one is asking what lens were you using
for the macro?
Mm-hmm.
So it's the Rodenstock 105mm lens, which is probably the greatest macro lens that's ever been created. It's a 5.6, but it can really get to such tiny distances from a subject. So it's an absolutely fantastic lens. And again, it's Rodenstock class, so one of the sharpest that you can find.
Yeah, and there essentially is sort of one that's kind of connected to that, and I think I can probably answer this. It says, does the lens breathe when you take several shots at different points of focus? Does the image grow? And so forth. And a lot of that comes down to the way that we do a focus stack, right? Yep. If I'm doing it with a camera where I am rotating the lens, right? I'm changing the focus of the lens itself, then you're going to have some breathing, you're going to have some size changes and things like that. So you have sort of limitations with that method. If you do what Andre was doing here, where the camera has a fixed focus on a rail and the rail moves the camera back and forth, you get much less of that effect. And so it's much better for these kind of super, super macro situations.
And again, the phase is a little bit different. This is kind of another extreme with it, but to even get to the point of shooting these bugs, you have to do three mathematical calculations to figure out your magnification on the lens, the distance from the insect to the front of the lens, and the distance from the mm-hmm. back of the lens to the sensor. So these are all, depending on the size of the specimen, there's all these charts that you have to literally do mathematical calculations to figure out those distances. So it's not a simple plug and play, hit shutter and go.
And there's a question about the servo system you were using, basically, what was moving the camera. That was sort of the one of three in the world, right?
Yeah. At the time I got this, Alpa were kind enough to lend this prototype equipment out. I mentioned to them what I was trying to do, and then really trying to capture something that's not really been done before. And I said, we've got a solution for you. This might work, but it was a prototype. So that's I had some growing pains, and now it's worked out. But it's basically an automated focus stack rail. So you choose. You focus your near point, you choose your far point, you choose what sort of magnification you want it to be, the increments, which I'm doing 20 microns. You can do 80 if you want. And it automatically does it for you. So it knows every 20 microns, it takes an image and moves forward, And you can set a delay if you need the camera to, for the IQ4 to give enough time for it to buffer all the images. Otherwise it can just bunch up too much and mm-hmm. Have some issues on that front. So. I think someone was mentioning this might be a good time to talk about what do I do with these prints. What's my hope for once these are done? My hope is still to complete this project, because it's just been going on for quite some time. Again, because of the time to make them, the time to do the retouching, and obviously just the costs involved. But the hope is to obviously work with some galleries and museums. I know the Natural History Museum of San Diego wants to do an exhibition. So ultimately, it really comes down to printing and being able to get that kind of resolution. And if I may, I'd like to take you on a little journey, because I have one of these printed. It actually was a defective print, and there's nothing wrong with the print, but there was a scratch on the plexi on the front of it. But I can show you what it looks like in person and how big you can mm-hmm. you can really push these files. So I have it up on my wall. If we can show you. So this is another one that I did. This is a very early on. This is actually on the 100 megapixel back. This is on the IQ3. So what you just saw there was on the IQ4 with 23% more resolution. So this is the kind of level of quality that you end up getting once it's done. And this is a 48x72 print. So quite a large, quite a large size print that we're hopefully going to be doing some gallery showing, especially in the wings. I don't know if you can see this, but you can see the individual hairs on the wing itself. Yeah, so that's the size.
Once you get back in, I was just going to go back and look at some of the earlier questions. Let's see. There was there was one question which came down to the X-ray shot that you showed earlier, the MacBook Pro and the controller in the phase one. How did you actually do that?
That was tough. You can't just walk into a practice and say, hey, I want to use your X-ray machine. You actually need to have a human being associated with an X-ray that gets taken. So it took me, again, months to find someone that I convinced them, hey, I want to shoot some everyday products. Can I use your X-ray machine? So many turned me down, but ultimately I found one and set aside some time where I just physically went to their office, and for an hour on three or four occasions, I just brought in all these pieces of technology. And the technology worked better. I actually tried it with a Scorpion. I wanted to see what the inside of the Scorpion would look like, if it would even come through in terms of the skeleton. It didn't. It seems like technology and the sort of moving pieces inside of, I did a Dyson vacuum, which is really kind of cool. I did a bulb, which was really interesting to see the filaments inside. So that's kind of where that project came from. Trying to stay creative. I wanted to see it, and if it didn't work, it didn't work. You wouldn't believe how many projects I've done that will never see the light of day, because it just wasn't good enough. I tried. I had an idea, and it massively failed. But I learned something from it that I then try and apply somewhere else, even if it's a good learning or a bad learning. Or that just didn't work. It wasn't going to, it's not going to happen for the next one. So I think it's just important to keep trying to be creative, even if you keep making mistakes.
Yeah. Lighting wise, are you typically using, for instance, like, let's say when you're doing the McLaren stuff, are you using strobes, continuous lighting?
So for the McLaren shoot that we did, I knew I needed some help with lighting, just because of the magnitude of the shoot itself and sort of the royalty of these cars. And I wanted to bring some external help for people that do this for a living. And I ended up working with two of the best in the industry, and I was expecting to be using strobes because that's what I've done before, but they were adamant that I use continuous lighting. So all of that was done with continuous lighting, bouncing off the ceiling, bouncing off using flags to darken a certain area, or just moving everything around. And probably for each angle of the car, it's maybe between 8 and 14 different lighting setups that each of them were also focus stacked. So if we lit the back, just the back wing, I don't care about anything else with the front of the car, then we focus stack
the whole thing.
Exactly. And then you move a little to the left and you focus and you light that section and you light the interior, and each one of those are focus stacked. That's why it takes so many images. And you need a big hard drive, which is why these are an absolute godsend. Just to have them, SSDs, they change your entire life.
What else? I think one of the things that strikes me is you travel a ton. I also travel a ton. And you know, especially now sort of being at home and kind of cooped up and not traveling. For me, it's a huge lifestyle change. For you, I imagine it's a huge lifestyle change. One of the things that I think I've probably noticed more than anything else is how that travel is sort of affects the way I work and affects the way I do things and affects the way that I think about things. Do you find that, you know, for instance, does your experience travel, would you say that that has translated into your willingness to sort of try all sorts of new things just in photography?
I don't think so. I think I'm just genuinely a very inquisitive person. I like to see the world. I like to see different things. But for me, I'm always going to travel. I'm always going to be getting up in a helicopter trying to shoot something. The fact that I'm now working on projects that I find exciting, and even CERN, I'm probably never going to print anything of CERN. I'm doing that because I find it interesting. I want to see it for myself. I want to experience it. There's always going to be something that, even when I'm not traveling, I'm going to find something. I've got 15 projects that I'm working on right now that are completely different and nothing to do with travel or aerial. These are things that I want to try out, and no one's going to see them. No one's going to know about them unless they come out to be good. And that's what keeps me going. I really, and especially now, you know, I'm not dying as much as I thought I would because I can't travel or get up in a helicopter, because I have a home studio where, in fact, even I shoot for Nike here in Los Angeles. They're closed. They can't shoot. And they actually reached out to me saying, we need to send you some product. Can you shoot it for us? So I have other things that I can continue to shoot at home in my studio to sort of experiment and keep myself busy, because otherwise I'd be going insane, which I'm sure a lot of people probably are.
Yeah. You know, one of the things that I think, and I know we've have talked a lot about, is that you transitioned from shooting sort of 35 millimeter kind of traditional DSLR size into medium format. You know, what was that for you? What was that transition like? Because I know for me, I kind of switched over once I started shooting medium format. I was back in the shooting, you know, medium format film. Once I did that, it completely changed the way that I worked with the camera, and I never wanted to go back. And I've sort of, you know, for me, part of never wanting to go back was saying, well, I think I want to go work for a company like Phase One, and where I can always shoot these cameras. And so, you know, I'm in this little privileged position, but I do notice how the camera itself forces me to think differently, shoot differently, work differently, and I get better results regardless of that. What would you say your experience has been, and what have some of, let's say, maybe the challenges been to coming over to medium format?
Yeah, I think, so I was shooting Canon previously. I've only shot Canon before, and making the transition to medium format, I think the biggest thing that you first see is the quality of the file. It's a much larger sensor. The pixels are better quality, the larger pixels. So immediately just looking at a regular TIFF file, that's the first thing that comes to you. But that's not really the main reason why I wanted to make that change. I didn't necessarily get it for the megapixels. Yes, it's great to have all that detail. Yes, it's great to be able to zoom in on an image without destroying the file. I think it's really the entire package for me, especially now with the XF, you have that infinity platform that the camera is just constantly getting better. Mm-hmm. I can't do that with another camera system. I'd have to buy a brand new one whenever there's a new technology that they come out. Whereas with this, I get the feeling that, you know, FaZe really listens to their photographers, and the updates that they make are things that we find out in the field that we'd like to see improved. So it's just constantly being added. I don't have to buy it all over again. How was the learning curve? It's really the same. If you really break it down, it's still the same relationship between your aperture, your shutter, your ISO, and it still has a shutter button. It's the principles are there, but I think what it does is it really did force you to slow down a little bit. It does make you think about, what am I really trying to shoot here? What am I really trying to do? Rather than being a little bit sort of gung-ho with, I want to go here and I want to shoot everything. It has forced me to slow down. Even in my aerial work, I'm not shooting as much because I'm really thinking, what exactly am I trying to say in this image? I don't know if that fully answers your question, yeah. It's a more complete system that I feel is, it fits my style of shooting, and it's allowed, I think what it's really done, it's allowed me to expand and grow mm-hmm. as I'm changing my style or what I'm trying to do.
Yeah. Here's sort of what I actually think is a fantastic question that just came in, which is, so early on you mentioned playing with color. Mm-hmm. So when you think about color, like, do you believe that color should be captured as accurately as possible, or something to sort of exaggerate and manipulate and post? In the question, say, you know, sort of like a painter. So I sort of see it as, you know, are you aiming more to, let's say, be fairly accurate, and you're just working with subjects that are incredibly colorful, or is it something that you're intentionally exaggerating?
So I think that's a personal preference, depending on the kind of photography and eye that you want to show. From my perspective, I do seek out color. I seek out subjects that are colorful. That's why I like shooting salt flats a great deal, because you have that, all these varying different nuances and pinks and yellows and blues that I find fascinating. And that's one of the reasons why I'm choosing some of the subjects for the bugs. You know, I'm looking for texture. I'm looking for interesting colors that I know, you know, the camera sense is going to really pick up, and I can push a little bit. I want it to be what my eye sees. I mean, when it comes to my travel, I want it to, I can even actually show you the blue bug if I can find it, but I want to show people exactly what I saw. Now, do you need to work on that in Capture One and Photoshop and push it a little bit more? Absolutely. I think anyone that says they don't do that is probably lying or exaggerating. It's just a question of how far do you want it to go? When someone looks at my work, I want them to feel like they're there and I'm not exaggerating my colors. It really is that pink when I was in that helicopter. The blue of this bug, it really is that color. It's just, mm-hmm. I'm allowed to push that file just a little bit to really bring that out.
You know, I remember the first time I went to Iceland, and, you know, Iceland has these crazy sort of green, you know, yep. moss and things like that growing on these black hills. And I remember one of the stories that our guide was telling us was that, you know, back before people were going to Iceland, photographers were coming back with rolls of film that they shot these mountains on, and labs were saying, oh, there's something wrong with this film. These colors aren't real.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Just because nobody knew what they were getting into, but they were that intense. You know, and I even look at the pictures, like, these colors don't seem real. They look like I just went nuts on the saturation slider.
And I think that's the danger as well that we're sort of living in the sort of Instagram world. And mm-hmm. a lot of there are those photographers that, and that's perfectly fine, that's the platform that they want to show it. And to grab that attention of people, they feel the need that they do want to crank up these colors, because it's going to automatically, you know, you're going to be drawn to it because it's colorful, it's bright. And again, it depends the kind of photographer you want. I am not a photographer for Instagram. I don't think, you know, I believe that the camera should be the one doing all the talking in terms of, can it replicate what my eyeball saw in that split second? And can it do it in the most accurate way possible?
Yeah.
That's really what it comes down to. And that's why I prefer, that's why I want to shoot. I want to shoot on a phase one. I don't have to. I want to. All these experiences that I have with the, whether it's the bugs or the McLaren or CERN or 15 other ones that I have coming up, I don't know if I'm going to get the chance to do that again, you know? So yeah. For me, I want to be able to shoot it on the best resolution, the best quality file, that even in 5 years from now, I can look back at that file and still be able to hold its weight against anything else that's out there in the market. And I think that's a really powerful thing. And yeah, look, there are a few things that shooting medium format potentially has some drawbacks, but when you look at that file, all of those make sense and go away. And that's the way that I feel about that one on the medium format side of things. How are the questions looking?
I can
pick one.
yeah, go for it.
How do you light the insects from Henry? With great difficulty. One of the reasons why it took so long at the beginning before I even was really working on a final file for one of the bugs was it took me so long to really try and get that right lighting. I used the one light setup. I used the two light setup. I used a three and a four light setup. I shot it in a styrofoam box, which everyone was telling me is the way to go. I personally didn't find that to be the right way. Too much light bounce everywhere. So really it just came down to narrowing, trying something, making a mistake, narrowing it down, and then seeing what it looks like. The problem is if you're doing a watch, you can find those results fairly quickly. Whereas with something like this, it just takes that much longer because of how long it takes to process. Even before, I wouldn't even send it to a retoucher, just for me to see the final flattened TIFF file to see what it looks like. It just takes so long, along with all the problems of, oh, the AC turned on, or my cats decided to have a fight upstairs outside my studio and rattle the floor. I have to start all over again. So there's all those, I knew where I wanted to go. It just takes, there were so many steps in the way for me to be able to get to that point. And that's why it's taken so long to really do. I don't know if that answers your question, but I'm shooting also through a scrim. So I tried hard lights, I tried soft lights, I tried a combination of hard and soft, depending on which ones. And it's really narrowing it down to the one that you feel looks the most natural, that people can look at and go, wow, you didn't just completely blow out the skin or the texture that it has on it. So a lot of trial and error.
Yeah. I think the other one is sort of along those lines of thinking about setups. The images you had with the model and the colored powder, what was your, you know, sort of your technique for that, from let's say lighting to makeup? Can you give us sort of the 2 minute rundown of what goes into a shot like that?
I can, let me pull it back up again. That was my first ever studio shot that I've ever done. And quite honestly, it was, you're talking about, I'm talking about this one, I believe, right? Yeah.
Yeah. All right. I think maybe that one, and maybe I'm just looking at the ones that were on the really dark, yeah, the dust.
So we did an opposite one of this. So this is the second project. The first one was we actually painted her whole body white, and this lovely model actually shaved her head for us for this particular project, which was interesting. But we had her painted white first, and we dripped paint on her. So the first project was her being white, and we dripped paint, and this was sort of the opposite of that. And what we ended up throwing on her was actually holly powder. So if you take multiple holly powders that are, and they're very vibrant colors, again, from the Indian culture. Yeah. And I went to India specifically to shoot the holly powder. And that's kind of where I got the inspiration. I wanted to recreate that in a fine art environment. And sort of what kind of message are you really sort of telling? But it was literally, there wasn't really a thought process in the sense of I want this to fall like here. It was very much my assistant was getting it in the hand and just throwing it on her. Let's see what that looks like. And then just keep piling it on, and sort of at what point does it become too much and it gets too busy, which we found sort of three colors to be that kind of spot. But obviously we use flash, Hisense flash on this one, and it was a one shot take. The phase doesn't shoot 10 frames a second, so you really had to really think about what you're trying to capture, how and get everyone involved to be on the same page, because to redo again might take a little bit of time. So a lot of practice, a lot of trial and error, a lot of again, like I said, things that people are just not going to see, that I learned something from that one that I'm then applying to this particular project, and that's what makes it work. And we managed to get what we wanted to get. So. As far as, just in case anyone's interested, obviously everyone being at home and stuck, and we don't feel like we want to be creative, and it's difficult to keep your mind engaged and looking forward to things, especially that we don't know when we are going or back. I know for a fact I had 3 McLaren shoots that had to be delayed. I had a trip, a 5-country trip to Asia that had to get delayed. Faroe Islands was in the books. I've got a project with the Griffith Observatory. Again, I don't know if this is being done to the level that I want to do it, but the Griffith Observatory has allowed me to come and use their telescope and actually shoot the phase one through the shoot the telescope, obviously using the phase one and seeing what we can capture. So that was meant to happen, which is now being put on hold. Another one using the XT, which is the amazing camera system, the technical, the field camera system that you have back there. Yeah, I genuinely love that piece of kit. Los Angeles has incredible theaters, and they're, you know, these Art Deco buildings inside that are so incredibly intricate and beautifully lit. So I wanted to do a project, and I reached out to the Society for Theater Restoration, whereby I traveled to these theaters and capture them using the XT. And again, because of all the benefits of shooting on a 23 or a 32, to then stitch all the way across. So you get the stage, you get the ceilings that are just an incredible detail with that. So that unfortunately had to get put on hold. I shot three of them so far, but another one is, and one of the final ones is doing an eyeball project. I want to focus stack a live human eyeball, again, with the 150 to see that detail. And that is a lot harder than you think to really try and do, because obviously you can't stand still for as long.
You're going to blink and you're going to do other things.
Any movement on that, especially with the 150, is going to come through. So we found a pretty ingenious way of how we can do that. I haven't been able to test it because there's no one really here for me to test. So just, again, I'm always looking for different things that are completely varied in subject to keep my brain ticking.
I know we mentioned this earlier, but just kind of make sure people, which focus stacking software are you using it, and what is it that you like about that one particularly?
So if you're doing shallow stacks, so for example, the McLaren or the watches, where you only need between 30 to 60, Helicon does a very good job of that. When you're doing larger stacks, like the bug project that I have, where it's anywhere from 500 images to 6,000, Helicon doesn't quite do as good of a job. So I actually use Zerene, Zerene system. And what's been really amazing about that is the developer of Zerene, this gentleman out of Washington, Rick Littlefield, if I can give him a shout out, because I wouldn't be anywhere near without him. He's dedicated his entire life to deep stacks and the software behind it. He was an engineer and he really built this from the ground up. So I reached out to him and he's been the one, the first few bugs I did, he actually processed himself because I didn't know how to use the software and it's quite complicated. In fact, he even built me special code for Zerene that no one else has to be able to handle some of the things that I was doing. Well, things such as slabbing, if anyone is really interested, I don't know how deep I want to get into this, but basically slabbing is taking, rather than doing an entire stack of 6,000 all at the same time, it gets the first 10 with the 3 overlap and you slab them that way. So you're actually focus stacking slabs that you then focus stack again. So that was built into it, which has been really helpful to make sure that my edges are sharp and don't have any issues when they finally get put together. So Zerene is really fantastic when it comes to deep stacks and shallow stacks. I mean, there's no reason to not use it for shallow, but especially it really is great at doing a deep stacks. So I think there was a few questions that I saw regarding a regular 35 mil camera and a medium format. And I do have an example to show what I wanted to do, a sort of a comparison between a 35 mil and a phase one. Now, this is an image that I shot quite a while back. It was do not question the composition on this one. We're only doing the sharpness test of Brooklyn Bridge. And I wanted to be able to compare it with an IQ4. Obviously, I wanted to use the same location. But even if we zoom in at this is 100% right here, and you're looking at the quality and the sharpness along the metal itself, and obviously just the edges, comparing that to, again, 150, and I know this is a little bit closer, so the composition is a little bit off, but getting into the 100 when it settles, I mean, it's just such a cleaner file. The noise levels are that much more controlled. The edges are super sharp and it just, it's a very big difference. I can try and do a comparison side by side. And again, the composition is a little bit closer on this one, but just being able to really see the difference. The quality, I mentioned, is
you're not getting that sort of muddiness where the finer details are sort of blending together.
Yeah, and like I said, my biggest benefit, in my personal opinion, is just the quality of the files and how far I can push them in post without destroying them. Well, for my retoucher to push them in post. When I had the Canon file, if I wanted to, bring up a little bit, bring up the shadows, I would just start seeing all of that pixelation coming through. I'd start seeing all the sort of red channels really sort of popping up. Whereas with the phase, it just has that much more detail. 16 bit of color with now 17 stops of dynamic range, pretty much when you're doing frame averaging, that's a lot of data. That's a lot of flexibility that it's giving you to really kind of be that much more expressive and push the file to a level that you just can't do on the other end, because the file just starts breaking down. So to me, that's one of the biggest advantages from my line of work. Is making sure that my files are incredibly clean. I do not like noise in my images. That's just a personal preference. So I try and shoot at 50 ISO as much as possible. It's again, file size, flexibility, and just nice big megapixels and the sensors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One of the, some more little questions about setup stuff. When you're shooting aerial, what are you typically using for a lens? And are you using any sort of external stabilization, like a gyro?
Yeah, I don't. I've read some mixed reviews, whether they really do work. And also, I've tried it once, and it really limits my, my flexibility in terms of movement. Mm-hmm. I want to be really fluid. So the communication that I have with the pilot is crucial. After I've done the research of where I want to go, I have a brief with him. I tell him exactly where I want to be. Again, I've done this for quite some time, so I know the altitude that I want to be at. I want to know roughly the speed that I want to be going. And the way that I like to shoot is shooting straight down. So I don't shoot straight out of the helicopter. So for me to be able to do that, he needs to really start corkscrewing around a particular object. So as we're flying, I see something, I tell him, okay, now you can start your turn. I use the 40 to 80 a lot. It's just because of that, because of the zoom flexibility, it gives me a little bit more option. And the 35 is also a great lens if I want to get a little bit wider. So I don't use a gyro. I need to be fluid. I'm always in manual mode, and I'm adjusting all the ISO, the shutter speed, and the f-stop. And it also depends on what I'm shooting. Keep in mind, you're constantly moving around. You're going around in a circle. Forget the fact that blood's pumping into your brain because you're pulling one and a half G's sometimes when you're going down. If you're shooting something that's white, so let's say you're shooting a salt flat with a lot of white and the sun is out, that's going to be kicking a lot of light back up. So you can increase your shutter speed. You can decrease your ISO. But all of a sudden, in a split second, you could be going over something that's a lot darker. You need to then quickly adjust that. So I don't use a gyro. I need to be really flexible so I can actually be fluid with my movement. I just think it just gives you that flexibility and the freedom to be able to hunt down different compositions.
Yeah, that's great. So I think we're just about coming up on time here. So I want to thank everybody for hanging with us, visiting with us, and kind of listening to what we have to say. I know I'm mostly just adding little side comments here and there. But thank you, Andre. This has been absolutely fantastic.
Thank you for having me.
It's been a thrill for me to you know, work with you over the last 2 years and kind of get an inside view of some of your projects. And, you know, we're all kind of looking forward to what's next. For everybody else out there, you know, please stay safe. As they all say, wash your hands, right? We're going to get through this. In the meantime, you know, at phase one, we're still here doing support. If you have questions, if you have technical questions, anything like that, everybody that works in the support team on my side, we all know photography. We've all been doing photography for years. We know the product. So please click on the support page at phase one, reach out to us with any questions that you have. We're happy to answer them. We're happy to give you guidance. We're happy to give you tips on phase one cameras and things like that. We've also taken to setting up abilities to do remote demonstrations and things like that. So if you have any interest in phase one hardware, reach out to any phase one partner and they can even help get you set up with a remote demo from someone like me or one of my colleagues around the world. So, we're here to help. We're here to give as much information as we can. And I don't actually have the schedule in front of me. I probably should have planned for this, but there's more webinars coming in the coming days and weeks. So stay tuned. Thanks again. And we'd love to have you back in the future.
Yeah. And thank you for having me again. And just from my perspective, if anyone has any other questions that we didn't get to, I'm more than happy to set up a time or a call or just email me. And I'll be more than happy to go through those in more detail. We just ran out of time on this one.
Great.
Cool. Thank you. Thank you guys. Appreciate it. Stay safe.